Hey there, and welcome to my video about math behind AI. My name's Frank, and I'm passionate about mathematics, and I hope I can show you a little bit about my passion. So this is gonna be a three-part series about math behind AI. It's not about modeling and how to optimize our neural system to achieve certain effects. This is about how to understand the mathematics behind AI. And the first part is about setting up the optimization problem. So what you should already have heard of, we will need some basic mathematical tools like basic matrix vector operations, basic analysis like standard functions, stuff like that. And it's good to have some basic understanding of mathematical optimization, which is not needed but helpful. It's helpful if you have already seen a deep neural network and have some basic understanding about it, but it's not needed. I will explain to you hopefully in detail, so that this knowledge is not needed to understand this video. So during this video, I want to analyze a system which performs the classical tasks of text recognition. You see here, if you follow my laser pointer, different variants of the same character. In this case, number two, we have handwritten style, we have some dotted stuff, we have a blurred version, and we want our system to recognize all of this as the number two. For the human eye, or for the human being, it's very easy to see, oh, this is a two, I've seen this before, it's blurred, but I don't care. This is also a two, this is a two, even though it has some spacing in between here. But, well, the human eye, the human brain, doesn't have any problems with identifying this picture as the number two. Because we have to differentiate between the picture itself and the information stored behind it. So we have just a picture, and the information stored is, in this case, number two. And for classical systems, it's very easy, it's very hard actually to identify handwritten numbers as the correct characters. But neural systems have performed greatly on this task. So before we actually come to our neural system, we have to perform some work ahead. We have to transform the input data in something our system can actually understand. So we take our picture, our number two here, and put over and lay over a 20 times 20 mesh. And if in one of these squares, Is there a little black contained in it, we just fill it up. So we end up with a coarse version of our original picture. You can still see it's a two, but it's a little bit more coarse. Why are we doing this? Because now we can transform this picture into a matrix which simply contains one and zeros. Zero, we put in a zero. If the associated square does not contain any black, or one if it is black. So you have we end up with this matrix. And later on, it will be also important to know that every matrix can be expressed as a vector, simply by writing it in one row. Nothing special about it, but it's a useful transformation to have a basis our system can work with. So here you can see the whole transformation of the input data from the original picture to the coarsened version to the matrix, and from the matrix to the vector. And this vector is something our system can understand, or hopefully will understand, and we'll recognize this as a number two. Okay, so keep this in mind. We will need this later on. Okay, so I guess everybody has seen this picture of a neural network before, but I will just explain it. These green, blue, and red dots are called nodes, and a compilation of nodes is called a layer. We have here three different types of layers. So let's start with the input layer. The input layer, as you can see here, is on the left side and is filled with input 1, 2, and 3. This is actually where our vectors come into play, because every node will be associated with one part of the vector. And from this input layer, we move on to the next layer. So you see, every node here is connected with each node of the next layer. So this is why it's called a fully connected neural network. The hidden layer is the next layer is the so-called hidden layer. Why is it called hidden layer? Because you cannot see it from the outside. The hidden layer is where the magic happens, but you cannot see it from the outside, because from the outside you can just see the input layer and the output layer. Think about the hidden layer as a sort of a black box, if you want to. I just draw here one hidden layer, but of course you can have 1, 2, 3, whatever you want to. And the hidden layer is now connected with the output layer. And from the output layer, we can generate the output, and the output will give us the information. So here you will put on the image, and here you will receive the information of the image in a certain way. Okay, but how does information travel through a neural network? I will first do this in a very symbolic way, and we'll do it with the hard mathematics later on. So let's start with the input layer. We have our information we have our picture coming in from the left, so input 1, 2, and 3. And let's assume that input 1 is a 0. This will not activate the node, so that's why it's still gray. But input 2 and 3 will activate the node 2 and 3. You can think of a neural cell in the brain, which now is activated and will fire to the next connected neural cells. And this is what will happen. So this activated nodes will fire to the nodes in the hidden layer and will activate, for instance, this node here, here, and here. These three nodes fire to the output layer and will activate the node associated with output 1. And this is something we now can analyze and understand. So we know, okay, if we put in this information, so 0, 1, 1, we'll end up with output 1. And hopefully this is something useful. Okay, but what does activation means in a mathematical way? So let's talk a little bit about activation of a node. Let's jump a little bit more into mathematics and make it in a concrete. Let's make it more understandable for us. So we have three nodes connected to one node. And each node has a certain value. It's just a number, 1, 2, 3, 4, 4.5, whatever you want to. These values are denoted with x1, x2, x3, and y. But the most important thing is every connection has a certain weight attached. These weights are called w1, w2, w3. And what you now do is to compute the value of y is you just combine the weights with the values of x1, x2, x3 in a linear way. So we end up with a linear combination. So y is just w1 times x1 plus w2 times x2 plus w3 times x3. But wait, we make it a little bit more complicated. To make it more complicated, and I will tell you in a little bit why we need to make it more complicated, we plug this linear combination into an activation function, which is called s, which is, in our case, just a function r to r. And for more freedom, we also add a so-called layer parameter, which is just a revalue and is added to our linear combination and then plugged in into the activation function S. And we end up with the value Y. So this is how the activation, or how the node, how the value Y of the node is computed. But why do we actually need this activation function? I mean, why do we need it? It's just an artificial construct for now. An activation function, it comes from biology. A neural cell only fires to its connected cells when a certain threshold is reached. And this is, we want to model this in a certain way, but there's also a very important mathematical reason why we need this nonlinear function. First of all, it should be, and it usually is, a nonlinear function, and this introduces nonlinearity into our neural system. And we need this to achieve very cool stuff. So assume for a second that S, our activation function, is not present, or is the identity, which is basically the same. Then every layer can be expressed as a linear function. It's just, as we see later on, it's just a matrix vector operation. And if you have more than one layer, well, linear combination of linear functions are still linear. So our whole neural network will basically consist of a linear operation. And if you go a little bit more into detail, you can very easily see that without a activation function, every neural network, every fully connected neural network can be expressed or can be interpreted as a network with just one hidden layer. So we lose the depth in our neural network, and this is actually where the magic happens. This is where the cool stuff will happen. So if you ignore the, or if you neglect the activation function, you can still do cool stuff. But with the nonlinearity, you can do very cool stuff. So you actually need this for achieving very fancy stuff. You are very free in choosing the activation function. Every node or every layer can have its different activation function. This depends heavily on the modeling process. So the modeling process, or the choosing of the activation function, depends on what you want to achieve with your system. This is very complex and a very sophisticated topic, and we cannot just simply say, oh, you want to do that? Choose this activation function. Oh, you want to do the other stuff? Let's take another one. No. It's very crucial and very tricky to choose the correct activation function. Also, choosing the right system is a tough choice. How does an activation function actually look like? So the popular activation functions you can see here, it's the sigmoid function. I plotted the formula up here, you can see it here, and the plot of the graph you can see here. Yes, the sigmoid function has the nice property of if you have a very low activation, you have a very low x value, you also have a very low y value, it's close to zero. It's sometimes this is a good property to have. And more common and more famous is the so-called rectified linear unit, or in short, ReLU function. Well, you just cut off everything which is below zero and put it to zero, because it's very simple and it works fine. But I mean, you can see the formula here, it's just the maximum of zero and x. It has certain advantages and disadvantages, like everything has in life. For instance, it's unbounded, right? If you have a very high x value, your ReLU function will also be very high. Sometimes this causes issues or problems you want to avoid. Also, this is something we will talk about in the next video. this function is continuous but not differentiable in x in zero. And this may cause some problems, but smart people have thought about some solutions. Here are some more activation functions. I want to point out the so-called soft plus functions, which is actually just a smooth approximation of the reload function. So with smooth, I mean differentiable. And then there are a whole slew of activation functions. You have the tangens, hyperbolic course, you have exponential linear unit, you have the scaled exponential linear unit, you have stuff, very, 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 a lot of functions. You can come up with your own functions if it suits you, but keep it nonlinear. This will make things cooler. No, it actually depends on the modeling process, but as far as I know, the most popular activation functions are nonlinear. Okay, now we put everything together. Here you can see two fully connected layers. You have the layer 1 on the left side, layer 2 on the right side. The values of layer 1 are denoted with x1, x2, x3. And for layer 2, it's y1, y2, and y3. Every node of layer 1 is connected with every node of each node of layer 2. And, well, let's introduce some notations. Every connection has its own weight. So every connection from layer 1 to y1, which is the first node of the second layer, is denoted by w11, w12, w13. For y2, it's w21, w22, w23, and similar for y3, it's w31, w32, and w33. Again, for y1, we just compute the linear combination, add the layer parameter, and apply our activation function, and we end up with the value of y1. Similar for y2 and for y3. And if you have heard linear analysis and if you have seen some matrix vector multiplication, this thing here looks super familiar. This looks like a matrix vector multiplication. And think about this b1 by b2, b3 as a vector. Then we end up with a matrix vector multiplication. So this is where the mathematics starts. Here we now need some linear algebra. First define some stuff. So the values of layer 1, x1, x2, x3 are gathered in one vector and we call it x. Similar for layer 2, we call it y. And our weights are just stored as a matrix. So w11 up to w33 are stored in our matrix w. And our layer parameters are stored in the vector b. So if you now look closely, you can rewrite these three equations as one very short notation. So we have wx plus b applied and s applied to the result of this matrix vector operations. I'm doing here a slight change of notifications from here to here, because s here is a function from R to R, but here it's a multi-vectored function. But I mean, it's clear from the context, so there's no need to make things more complex as we need it. So if you see something like s applied to a vector, just think of s applied to each component. Okay, because later on we will have s for different type of dimensions. So sometimes s can be from R5 to R5, sometimes from R2 to R2. So, but it's always the same thing, always applied to each component. Okay, so we now have a very short notation to write the mathematics behind the neural network in a very short way. So it's just a matrix vector multiplication applied to our application function is applied. Okay, but our neural network will have mostly will have more than two hidden layers or more than two layers. So we need to generalize this a little bit, and we need to introduce a little more notation. This is, unfortunately, I cannot avoid this, but it's, well, let's take a look at it. Assume we are in the JF layer, which have DJ nodes. We now have to introduce our weight matrix, which is WJ, which has this sort of which have this dimension, and our layer parameter. Well, if you're lost here with the dimensions, don't worry. I will explain it in an example on the next slides. We just the most important thing that you should take here from this slide is that the weight matrix associated to the JF layer is denoted with WJ, and similar for the layer parameter. The layer parameter for the JF layer is denoted with BJ. Okay, so this might look tricky, especially if it comes to the dimensions. Why should we choose our weight matrix this way? Let's make it clearer on this small neural network. Again, we have it's a fully connected network. Sorry, and we have three hidden layers: one input layer and one output layer. And every hidden layer has different number of nodes. So here we have 5 nodes, 3 nodes, and the third one has 6 nodes. So how does this affect our dimension of the weight matrix? Let's take a look at this. In the upper frame, you will always see at which part of the neural network our information is actually where it is stored at the moment. So the information goes from left to right, and we start with our input layer. So that's why it's highlighted. So the input layer has 4 nodes. So we start with an input vector, which is in the R4. Now the information travels from the input layer to the first hidden layer. So the first hidden layer has the weight matrix associated, has the weight matrix W1 and layer parameter B1. And what we do now is we take our weight matrix W1, apply it to our initial vector, which is X0, and add our layer parameter. You can check the dimensions. X0 is in the R4. To have a matrix multiplicated, we need to be in the R4 times 4. And, well, this is what I meant here with the don't care about the activation function, just apply it for each component. If you do this, so you will end up with a vector in the R4, which is good because we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 nodes in the first hidden layer. So this is perfect. This turns out well. Now the information travels from the first hidden layer to the second hidden layer, which only consists of 3 nodes. So D2, which is the number of the nodes in the second layer, the second hidden layer, is 3. Our weight matrix is a 3x5 matrix, and you see how it works. We apply W2 to X1, add our layer parameter, and we end up with X2. But let's move to the third hidden layer, which consists of 6 nodes. So we have our weight matrix, which is 6x3. And our output vector X3 is in the R6, so there are 6 components. Okay, again, move to the output layer, the same procedure as we did before. But now we can do something new, because we can transform our output to a more understandable version, or to a more suitable version of our vector. And this is done by an additional function which I denoted by C. So C is just applied to the output of the third hidden layer. Okay, so why is this needed? Think, for instance, we want our values. Let's start maybe with the second part. We want to analyze our image if it contains a 2 or not. So the output value should be 1 or 0. 0, oh, it contains the 2, or 1, no, it does the other way around. 1, it contains the picture, in the picture 2, or 0, well, it does not contain the number 2. So we can achieve this by simply cutting off everything which is below 0 and cutting off everything which is below 1. This is done by this min-max component here. Or if you want to limit the output values to minus 1 and 1, then you can simply, well, apply this formula here, which is just taking the maximum value of the components and divide every component with this value. I know I'm repeating myself, but this depends on your modeling process. What do you want to achieve? If you want values between 0 and 1, do you want values between 5 and 7 for some reasons? Then you can apply some output functions to make it more suitable for your system. Okay, again, more notation, but hope this will be the last notation we will need. It's the most important. The layer parameters and the weights are the parameters which control our system. If we change the weights and the layer parameters, we end up with a different system. So these are the most important variables in this system. These are the parameters we want to control. We want to find the best parameter sets for our system, for our purpose. So let's collect all these variables in one big set. So big W1 was the weight matrix for our first layer, and B1 was the layer parameter for our first layer, and so on. Let's connect this in one big set. However, by using the simple embedding, we can understand this set as a vector. You know, just by writing each rows underneath, as we did it for the input value, for the transformation of the input data. So we can assume that this W, this weights and layer parameters, is just one big vector with dimension n. And n will be sometimes denoted as the degree of freedom, because this is where you can change your system. This is where you have the freedom of choosing your parameters. Okay. And to make things more readable, we have the so-called prediction function, which I denote by h, which is simply a function which maps the input vector to the output vector of the final layer. So this consists of two input values. We have our input x0 and our variable w. And if you plug it in and move through this whole process here, so x1, x2, x3, x4, and apply this vector z, you end up with the output of the final layer. So this is why the prediction function kind of tells you how is the output of our neural system if I apply this input vector. This is just a shorthand notation. Okay, but wait, there's more. We still have to introduce the so-called loss function. What is the loss function? The loss function is actually just a function which measures the difference between two vectors in a certain way. So look at this example here. So the first example, which is just the difference, the norm difference of h and y. And it is clear that if h is equal to y, then this function L is 0. If h is different from y, this function will be greater than 0. So think of a metric. But it doesn't have to be a metric, of course, but it should have some properties. So if h is very different from y, then also L applied to h and y should be great, it should be far away from zero. So this is just a way to measure the difference between h and y. How to choose this function L depends on your modeling, depends on what you want to achieve. If you want to achieve a very simple error measurement, you can just choose the norm difference. For instance, if you want to measure the sign difference, so if you have h and fy, we want to measure if h1 and y1 have different signs, you want to measure this in a certain way, then for instance, you can choose this more sophisticated function here. So again, it depends on your modeling, I know, and I'm repeating myself. But this loss function will be important in our mathematical optimization problem later on. Okay, so I told you we want to find the best parameter set for our network. But how do you find best? I mean, what sense do we have to understand this word? So let's come back to our simple network. We want to identify the number 2 from given pictures. I draw here a more general neural network with I know more than one hidden layer with a bigger input layer. But the most important thing is we only need one output node. So our output layer consists of one single node. Why is that so? Because our picture either contains the information 2 or not. So we want our output to be 1 if the picture contains the number 2, or it should be close to 0 or identical to 0 if this picture does not contain the number 2. But how do we get this information into our system? This is done by the so-called training the system. And if we want to train a system, we need a so-called training set. The training set is just a bunch of information where we know the desired output data. So first of all, let's collect in our case some pictures of numbers. So we have a 2, a 1, a 8, a 0, a 7, and a 9. And we transform them by our given input transformation to vectors, because the system can understand vectors. But we need to put more effort into it. We need to assign to this input vector a desired output vector. The output vector is just the information we want. So if this picture contains a 2, our output vector should be 1. If the picture doesn't contain a 2, it should be 0. So this has to be done by hand, or you have to collect the information elsewhere. This is cannot be provided by the system itself, at least for supervised learning. So this has to be done by hand, and let's assume we have a bunch of this, then we can train our system. So in a more general way, our training set is just a set of input vectors combined or connected with the desired output vector. So if I plug in x1 into my prediction function, which is just our neural system, I want it to be y1, or as good as possible. And here comes our optimization into play. Every time you hear something like, oh, find a parameter which is as close as possible to something, this is always optimization. So we have everything in hand to write down our optimization problem. And here it is. Let's take a look at it. We have a sum over our training data. Our training data consists of n pairs, xy and y1, and yi. And xy is plugged in into our prediction function and compared with the help of our loss function to the desired output value yi. This fraction 1 over n is just for scaling purposes. You can ignore it. And The optimization, comes into play if we want to minimize this whole system, because we want to minimize it in a such that every xi is as close to yi, but simultaneously for all our training data. That's why we have the sum over here, and that's why we minimize over our parameter set. So you want to find a perfect suit parameter, a perfect fitting parameter set W for our system with respect to our given training data, the training set. Whew. Okay, that's I think that's all for today. I've showed you how to analyze a neural, a fully connected deep neural network, how to translate it into mathematical language, and how to use this mathematical language and mathematical tools to write down the optimization problem to find the best suiting sets of weights and layer parameters for that given network. Well, I haven't told you how to solve this problem, actually. It's just, I mean, this is a highly non-linear optimization problem, because in this prediction function H, we have our non-linear activation function stored. And this makes the problem very non-linear, and this makes it very tricky to solve. But this how to solve this problem will be part of the next video. I hope you enjoyed this part one. If you have any questions, contact me. If you have any questions, if you have critics, if I did some mistakes, I hope not, but feel free to comment. And I hopefully see you in the next video. Have fun, see you around, and, well, enjoy mathematics. Bye.